Good morning, everyone. Or if you're listening in from a different time zone, good afternoon or good evening. And thank you for joining this webinar. Allow us first to introduce ourselves. My name is Douwe Rademaker. I'm the Global Leader of Market Strategy and Understanding at Ipsos.
And my name is Steven Naert. I'm the Global Solutions Lead for everything related to brand and portfolio at Ipsos.
Yep, and Stephen and I are going to talk to you today about how the COVID-19 virus has started to change consumer behavior and what brands can do to respond. And we'll share with you some highlights and some insights from some recent research we've done on the topic, but also from many conversations that we've had recently with our Chinese research and consultancy teams and our clients in China, who are just a few weeks ahead of us of the curve. So the spread of the virus is creating, of course, a lot of uncertainty. But we expect that there are both short-term and long-term changes in people's behavior. And when the context in which people live and live their lives are changing, brands should ask themselves, how could they respond and reassess how they can add value in light of this new reality? But for now, it seems that brands seem a little bit uncertain about if and how they can respond. They're afraid of being seen as opportunistic. And even companies that supply relevant health products, they're reluctant to mention the coronavirus as they don't want to appear to want to profit from the crisis. And what's complicated is I don't believe these things will return anytime soon to normal. You know, we've heard Rutte yesterday to say that the virtual lockdown in the Netherlands is going to last to June. The Prime Minister in Canada yesterday said that the virtual lockdown in Canada may last to August. So, and even if we're going to deal with the outbreak in the next weeks or months, you know, it's very likely that consumer behavior is going to make some durable changes and routines will have changed. So there's no option for brands to sit tight and to wait it out. But we believe that there are things that brands can do and can do now to add value to people's lives. We believe that the main discourse right now should be in empathizing, on understanding what people's lives are changing, and understanding that our very freedom to live our lives as we want is being challenged. And brands should focus on providing some real solutions that help with this new reality. And every crisis also brings an opportunity, as is demonstrated from this quote that probably most of you have seen from JFK. According to the quote, the Chinese translation of the crisis, Wei Ji, uses two characters, one for danger and one for opportunity. Well, in fact, it's not entirely true. My Chinese team has said, well, actually, the original meaning of Wei Ji is danger at a point of juncture, which is probably equally relevant to today's situation. But the popular culture has sort of picked it up, this new translation of danger and opportunity, so that actually even most native Chinese speakers interpret it in this way. So before we look at some different ways in which brands are responding, let's understand or have a look on how behavior is being impacted by the virus. And as I said, we will share some learnings from our research and consultancy teams in China just to inspire you, and especially the team in China who are just a few weeks ahead of us in dealing with the coronavirus can give us some and give us some learning. All right, so as this story is developing, we see more and more countries going into some form of lockdown. And even where there's no official lockdown in place, people have started to take action themselves. Many, though not everyone, but many people are keeping a safe social distance to other people. They, you know, many people have stopped, probably everyone has stopped travel. Companies have started to shut down stores before they have to. And I'm pretty sure that everyone or most of you that are listening right now to this webinar are doing that from home. Now, that inevitably will mean that over the next few months, people are going to spend much, much more time at home, alone, or with the family. Now, there are some benefits to this, right? In a way, life slows down. Finally, we have some more time to spend with the family. You know, for a stint, for instance, to play a board game, even though I have not convinced my kids that a board game is more interesting than a online game, but we'll keep trying. And you may also take some more time for yourself, binge watch our favorite series or read a good book. But for many people, being isolated will also be very stressful. They'll experience anxiety and a loss of control over their lives. And the Chinese media has reported that people are running around their apartments in circles around the beds or in their living rooms. Yesterday, I read about this French runner who ran a full marathon on his balcony in I think 6 hours and 48 minutes. And this was only a 23-foot balcony. So we also heard a story from a colleague in China who told us that she has not left her house for 5 weeks. And she's totally excited when a delivery mailman arrives, because finally it's someone she can talk to and see. Now, the spread of the virus and how this impacts how people are spending the day is going to have a big impact on people's spending behavior. And some categories are clearly struggling. I think, you know, air travel is an obvious one, right? With Schiphol is virtually closed and most of the airlines have grounded many of the planes. Or the automotive section. Car sales in China had dropped 92% for the first half of February, according to the China Passenger Car Association. It said that there was barely anybody at the car dealers in the first week of February, as most people stayed at home. And since China is the world's biggest car market, with selling more than 21 million vehicles last year, this is going to affect many of our automotive clients. But even Apple has already warned that the iPhones may soon go out of stock. But there's also quite a few categories beyond the obvious ones, like masks and disinfectants, that are set to thrive from all of this. You know, even though bars are closed and therefore the alcoholic beverages are going down, my friends in New York said the liquor sales in New York City, online sales, are up fivefold. And I've even heard that bars are offering takeout margaritas in New York City. So let's have a look at some data from China, where we see that being stuck at home certainly doesn't always mean you stop making purchases. And besides necessities such as medical and healthcare products and food, we also observed a rise in online education and entertainment, as well as some online medical services. And with staying home, we see that sportswear decreased the most. Offline entertainment activities and beauty products and services also decreased due to less social occasions. And in Europe too, we see some certain categories bloom as people started to stock up. I think all of you by now will have a good stock of toilet paper, but we also know that categories like confectionery are doing really well. So, with so much more time at home, people need ideas on how to spend the time. And according to a Chinese news source, searches for the word boring on social media site Weibo grow by 626%. And also in the Netherlands, we see a similar search. A lot of people are clearly already pretty bored. So what solutions can people consider? And as people are avoiding public places, they can no longer go to the gym. In China, people have started to do much more indoor exercise. This offers opportunities for sports brands and apps to give people inspiration on what kind of exercises they can do at home without too much equipment. And this is clearly starting to change people's routines. My boxing school is giving online trainings, and even though even two weeks ago, I said I would never do this training in my own house. Right now, every day, I'm doing my boxing classes from home. So we also know from China that people are spending a lot more time on housekeeping, not only for decluttering, but also for disinfect. And of course, they're spending more time at home. They make a bit more of a mess. But now is also a perfect time to start doing some decluttering, to apply some of those wise tips and tricks that were taught by the master of decluttering and organization, Marie Kondo. And in China, interestingly enough, one of the categories that is benefiting is yeast. The sale of yeast is up a lot. Now, you wonder why is that? Well, many people are stuck at home or are avoiding eating out at restaurants, and they've started to cook and to bake more often from home. And even if you look at the share price of Blue Apron is the US version of HelloFresh, is going through the roof at the moment where people are ordering boxes of foods to cook at home. And as millions of Chinese people are stuck at home, nightclubs across the country are keeping them entertained by holding cloud raves online. Clubbers have been turning into video platforms like Douyin, that's China's version of TikTok, and participating in them virtually. Here's some pictures what it looks like. And even closer to home, The Kick gave a live concert on Facebook last Saturday. In Ghent, Compass, one of the largest dance clubs in Belgium, is live streaming its dance parties. So some of the changes that we're seeing now can be expected only temporary, But once things go back to normal, we might stop baking at home and we will join the gym again. But we expect some long-term change as well. Think, for instance, about the increased use of e-commerce. And for many people, this has created a new routine. And once consumers have started a new routine, chances are that this will continue. And another long-term change that we're expecting is that people will reflect on some of the elements that have facilitated the spread of the virus. In China, for instance, people are very aware that the mortality of the coronavirus was worse because of the pollution, because it weakens the immune system and causes lung infections. By the way, an interesting side effect is what the Chinese team told us, is that the air pollution in the big Chinese cities has gone down so much that there's thousands and thousands of people less, there are less deaths because of the better air quality now than a few weeks ago. But a lot of people are also expect to generally look for more sustainable solutions, conscious of the impact our consumption has on the community and on our planet.
So what are brands around the world doing in response to this changing context, this new reality? Well, actually, for now, we see that a lot of brands are still hesitating to respond at all. A lot seem to want to stay clear from the topic because, as Douwe mentioned, they're afraid of looking like they are profiteering. But there are some obvious opportunities that we see for brands. Here are six different things that brands can do in response to the crisis in a way that benefits both your brand equity, but without being seen as opportunistic. These are things that you can do today. So you can give a little bit of comfort, show a bit of empathy, show some acts of kindness, help people to get through the crisis in style. Obviously, there is a big need to offer your products and services in a virtual way. People are looking for inspiration on how they can pass their time. And there is quite a bit of stress out there, so you brands can help relieve the tension a little bit. But before we talk about that, one thing, yes, that you do have to avoid at all costs is to come across as being overly opportunistic under the circumstances. And I think in the Netherlands, we had the example of Coolblue that already quite a few weeks ago, before the crisis, at least in the Netherlands, really started to escalate, suddenly increased a lot of their prices. Because they wanted to manage demand in anticipation of product shortages with the Chinese factories closing down. Business-wise, a very rational choice, but it did lead to a lot of negative buzz on social media, and potentially this could cause some long-term damage, so you have to be careful. But what can brands do? What are sort of positive actions that brands can do? Well, an easy way is to show empathy. Here's a few examples. Louis Vuitton posted a heartfelt message to Chinese customers using different social media platforms with the message, every paused journey will eventually restart. Louis Vuitton hopes you and your beloved ones stay safe and healthy. Guinness recently also came out with a similar message of hope to help people deal with the cancellation of all these St. Patrick's Day marches last week. They're reassuring people, we're not going anywhere, and someday all of us will march again. Or there's a message from Coke using their typical brand assets, the characters, staying apart is the best way to stay united. So they are showing empathy and at the same time reaffirming, let's say, what they want to be famous for, what their role in people's lives has always been. Then we also see quite a few examples of brands that are taking big or small initiatives to help stop the spread, or at least to avoid some of the negative impact. In the UK, for instance, up until yesterday, I should say, because stores are closing down there as well, Lush has been inviting people to come into their stores to wash their hands. Very simple, but very important thing. In India, a Unilever brand called Lifebuoy also used their advertising not to promote their own brand, but basically to say, no matter which brand you use, wash your hands. Then we see quite a few airlines, obviously they're going through rough times, that have stopped asking rebooking fees. Or you have a lot of, you know, if you booked a lot of travel, like I booked a ski holiday early April, it's not going to happen. But instead, they're offering out vouchers so that you can basically book the same accommodation in 12 months' time. And then another example is Amazon. So obviously, they often work with external partners. And what was happening in the early days is that the prices of masks and sanitizers on Amazon were going up by 2,000%. They've put a stop to this. So lots of little actions. We also see companies like L'Oreal, LVMH donating money, producing masks or hand sanitizers themselves. And very clearly, when these kind of things happen, they really get a big, big applause on social media. What else can brands do? In the streets of the Netherlands, just like across the world, we see more and more people wearing a face mask. So if you have to wear one, then it might as well be something that looks a little bit fashionable. So we've seen that from Shanghai to New York, there's a lot of brands launching masks with really stylish prints and colors, like what you see here are examples from Gucci and Louis Vuitton. And we also see a lot of examples of influencers sharing makeup looks on how to wear with these facial masks. Of course, you can extend this not just to how people look, but also to the environment where we will be spending, well, pretty much all of our days over the next few weeks or months. What can we do to make people's living rooms look prettier? How can brands help optimize your workspace? Like there's a big social campaign in France ongoing that encourages people to continue to dress up for work. So even if you're in front of your laptop the whole day, still put on a shirt, still put on a nice dress, and so on. The next thing. Of course, under the current circumstances, there's going to be a big further shift to virtual. Again, if you look at China, for instance, we know that car sales completely crashed, but online car sales went up in the first few weeks of the crisis. Obviously, there's a lot of professional meetings and exhibitions where we would have been flying around the world in order to participate that have now moved online. There's a lot of museums that are starting to curate their content in an online environment, and so on and so on. In many cases, people are going to get used to this kind of behavior. This is also what we saw with the SARS epidemic, for instance. That's when online shopping in a lot of places in Asia started to take off. This will stick around. There's also a lot of ways in which brands can help people entertain themselves at home. On the left is an example from a TV channel that's promoting streaming online content. Alibaba is organizing no meeting concerts. There's a lot of telecom providers that are increasing their data allowance, but then at the same time offering some free streaming content. Another initiative from a brand, Chipotle, they're organizing virtual hangouts where people can spend time chatting to celebrities. So each week through Twitter, they invite 3,000 fans for a session on Zoom. So this is definitely very inspiring territory. How can brands help people to make good use of the time they're spending at home? How can you offer extra entertainment? How can people keep their kids busy as they are locked inside the house because school's closed, because all leisure activities have stopped, and so on? And here, a lot of categories can play a role beyond the media, but also exercise, anything to do with food, education, gaming, DIY, cultural activities, and so on, and so on. In times of crisis, people rely on coping mechanisms. Some people are doing maybe a little bit more yoga or meditation, but we also see quite a lot of humor. Across Europe, in the past few weeks, the most used emoji has been tears full of joy. So yes, of course, there's a lot of concern, but people are also sharing a lot of jokes in order to make the tension and stress a little bit more bearable. And there's definitely things that brands can also do to take people's minds off the stress and anxiety. Of course, you need to be careful. You don't want to offend people. The example on the right, another one from Belgium, where is from a store that did a little promotion and buy two Coronas and get mort subite, which translates as instant death for free. That's probably a bridge too far for many people. So, of course, you have to be a bit careful, but we can help alleviate the stress that that a lot of consumers have. So, definitely a lot of things that brands can do right now. But if we're sort of inspired by, again, China, we can start to form an idea of what is ahead. I think we had a phase of disbelief, which we left behind us. Today, most European countries, we are in this adjustment phase. And, you know, because human beings are, you know, have always been very resilient creatures, we've faced a lot of challenges before, we will be able to deal with this new reality. So we expect that people pretty soon will get adjusted and we will move into a next phase, a new normal, a world where we have learned how to deal with social distancing. So maybe all the harshest measures, maybe something even more of a lockdown than what we have today, will last until June or August. But even then, with what we know right now, it's hard to imagine that all these measures will completely disappear and that we just go back to normal. And so there are definitely some lasting changes, some durable change that we should be expecting.
So as Stephen said, this is a new normal and we will be likely to be in this situation for quite a long time. And in this situation, consumers will start to form some new routines, some new durable behaviors. And especially when people are rethinking their consumption routines, this is now the time for us to get attention for our brands or for our new products. We can't just sort of hold our breath and sit this out. This really is the time to connect and be super relevant to our consumers. And as brand owners, as researchers, we need to accept this as a new normal, not as a sudden disruptive context. We need to focus on understanding what these new needs are, what new needs are emerging, and then need to look for ways in which we can respond to those needs. Now, that demands, I think, a lot from us, from our brands and from the brand owners. It means that we need to quickly adjust and adapt to this new situation. So before we open to some questions, Stephen, can you move to the next slide, please? Thanks. So before we go, let's leave you with a quote from Mark Ritson. He's a columnist in the Marketing Week. The wheels of industry, they need to keep turning so workers are paid and families are fed. And those wheels are best greased by effective marketing. So I believe we do have an important job to do. You know, brands have a role to play in addressing these new needs that are emerging in this change context. But we need to be creative, we need to be relevant, and we need to be considerate. And we have to do it now. We cannot wait until it's over. You know, this is the new normal and we have to deal with it. So with that, please let me know or type in a text if you have any questions, because I see already quite some questions coming. So I'll just give you a minute to type in your questions. So one of the questions is, how can we use social media and social listening to find out how people are changing their behavior? Stephen?
Yeah, I think so. There's two parts to that. One, should you be active on social media? And two, what can you learn from social media? I think the first one should be: should you be active? Yes, I think we, as I mentioned, we do. There's not a lot of brands conversation related to this crisis yet, but when brands are taking. Are showing these acts of kindness, they really get a lot of people applauding. Yeah? So there's a very, very positive response to brands. Second, should we be using social listening? Yes, because as we obviously the situation is changing very fast. What a difference a day makes. If we even trying to think back 1 week, yeah, we were living in a different reality. Yeah? And what social allows us to do is to stay very close, to monitor also, for instance, the mood. That we have a nice piece of research within Ipsos that was published, where you can see how in Italy, how over a very short period of time, the kind of the mood was changing from this is just the flu to complete fear, and people really panicking. So this is definitely so social media offers us a really good tool to stay very close to what is happening out there.
Thank you, Stephen. Another really good question is: some people say you should not run market research in this period. I'm interested in knowing if the reason why it is best not to test in these difficult times is mainly due to physical constraints, safety, avoiding to congregate in one place, or psychological. People are not in the mood to answer these questions, their bias, etc. So in other words, how is this virus impacting the market research industry, response-wise and methodology-wise? Stephen, you want to start and I will build on it?
Sure. Yeah. You know, I think it really it depends a little bit on the content. Eh? And so what we've been doing over the past few days is having a lot of conversations with clients case by case to see if this is the right time or not for things that impact, let's say, the longer feature. Like for instance. Doing a lot of research on, I'm just saying, airline travel is a little bit weird in the current circumstances. However, I think what we are observing is that there are obviously a lot of the plans that our clients have been making for this year are being reconsidered. So. Yeah. This idea of we shouldn't be holding our breath until this ends, we're in this for the long run. We need to understand needs are different. The needs that we have, or maybe they're the same, but we have to experience them in a very, very different context. Like I still want to provide a good life for my kids, but the guardrails of what I can do have obviously changed. So there is a lot of opportunity to understand how people's needs and behavior is being affected. And that's probably the most relevant research for today.
Yeah, let me add to that. I think there are three levels in which the research industry is changing. One is, as you just mentioned, Stephen, the content. I think there is now a more urgent need than ever to understand the changing consumer needs. Like compared to 2 or 3 weeks ago, consumer behavior has changed and it will continue to change, and it will have a long-term impact on how consumers engage with your brand. So I think now is the time, but you have to do it differently, right? It has to be fast, it has to be cheaper, it has to be online and mobile. There's less opportunity to do sort of face-to-face research, obviously. So there is, I believe for many of our clients, an urgent need to truly understand what this means in terms of consumer behavior and brand relationships, but it has to be done differently. or if you, mainly online and mobile. The third is there are a lot of things that we would have said it's not possible. For example, workshops, in engaging with your teams and workshopping the outcome of research, where we would normally say you have to do this face to face. Right now, we're doing these workshops online and through Zoom and getting everybody virtually involved. And it's interesting to see how incredibly successful that is. So I believe that as your industry, most of your industry, of the people who are listening, at the market research industry has to quickly reinvent themselves as well, as we are doing at the moment. Then there's a question, right, Stephen?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, go ahead.
Do you think, for example, in the automotive industry, that you have to invest in brand or in product? Well, that's an interesting question. I think it's not so much invest in brand or in product, but right now is the time to invest in the relationship, in the consumer experience, and show your clients that you're still here and you're still relevant. They might not buy your product this week or next week, but eventually they will. And they will now, and they will in time, reach out to those brands that have invested in the relationship in time of difficulty. So I truly believe that this is absolutely the time for brands to reach out in a respectful, considerate, but also super relevant way, even if you don't have a product to sell right now. Like for example, a company like KLM has to reach out now to remain relevant when times are going back up again. So I would say relationship.
And just one maybe message of hope for the automotive industry. We, in what we saw in China, complete collapse, short term, but longer term, there might be an impact, for instance, on people's willingness to use public transport. So we've actually already seen in China, you still have a lot of people without a car, that the interest to buy a car is actually increasing considerably.
One last question before we finish it off is, do you think consumers could be more engaged to consumer research because they have more time? We actually see that we're doing a lot of online communities where we have like a qual-quant relationship with a large group of consumers that are dedicating some significant time, and you can engage with them with questions, with ideas, with concepts. And it's actually interesting how easy it is right now to get respondents for these kind of engaged market research solutions. So the answer is yes, absolutely. It is actually easier now to do certain types of research than it was before. So another reason to not postpone, but actually do some of your research now. You can be faster, quicker, and have a higher ROI on your market research spend probably than you had before.
Yeah, and also for quantitative online, make use of online panels, etc. We also see like a slight uptake in response rate. So it's definitely not that people are like, this is not the time to be asking these questions. No, people are okay with research, that, with continuing to answer research surveys.
Okay, so Stephen, if you can move to the next slide.
Yeah.
So I think, given that we don't have any sort of more questions at the moment, but of course, please keep those questions coming. But I just want to make sure that we leave you with a few takeaways. Is the first one about the big impact, short term and long term, and let's start to think ahead, right? Be creative, relevant, and considerate. The second one, the brand should be careful, but they can engage and they should engage with the consumers or the customers in these times. And there's a lot of value that they can add. First, by showing empathy. Second, by providing solutions that help people in this situation. And finally, of course, we're here at Ipsos to help you navigate these challenging times. We can help you keep track of the situation, but we can also help you identify ways to even better and closer connect with your consumers or your customers in these challenging times. It may sound a little scary, but it's definitely not hopeless. And I think there's a lot of opportunity, as I said before, to build these really long-term relationship in these times. So at the end, hold on, there's one last question. Let me just see. Are there specific rules that you need to take into account if you would like to send consumer products for qual research? Stephen?
Yeah, this is definitely something where we need to be like a little bit careful, but you know, the even in these times, our distribution is still active. I'm sure a lot of you have been making use of bol.com and others to get products. So that's definitely something we can still organize. Yeah,
we just have to spend more time on we talk about quant, not just qual, but even for quant research, we can still do it. But we need to be a little bit more careful in cleaning and sanitizing the products before we send it out. But it's still, we still do it. So with that, I would like to thank everyone. And this, and actually, I'm really excited to see that so many people have signed up. This is clearly a topic that is super interesting to a lot of people. Or we all have more time on our hands to listen to these webinars, either one or the other. But I want to thank everyone for attending. And please reach out and connect with us today, tomorrow, in the weeks to come. We're here to help, and we look forward to hearing from you. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.